Same old place, same old people, the same old church, the same old steeple. It's good to be home.
And now I'm joined by Belturbet Dramatic Society, because we're going to get a bit of drama now for the Christmas season. Well, it'll be after Christmas, really, won't it? It'll be 29th.
The 29th, yeah.
And Belturbet Dramatic Society are putting on Conversations of a Homecoming. And I have the director. Are you a producer as well?
Yes.
Yeah, they're everything.
Yes.
So I have Fiona and Sophie and Derek here to join me and tell us all about Conversations of a Homecoming. And Fiona, I'm going to let you kick off first, because then we put the other two in the mix, so to speak. So tell us about this play.
Well, the play is set in the early 1970s in a typical Irish pub. Michael Ridge has returned home from America after spending 10 years there trying to make it as an actor. So he returns home to meet his old friends in this Irish pub. So he's obviously, what happens then is there is, as the title suggests, a conversation on a homecoming. So he tries to come to terms with the changes that have occurred in Ireland. So there's a lot of political changes, economic changes, and then he finds out that his own friends have also changed a lot. Right. So as the play progresses, the conversation kind of turns into a lively debate and at times a heated discussion, and that's where we kind of get the drama, and that comes out and we find out more about the characters, more about their past and how they've changed and how they're relating to each other now.
So it's topical for now as well, isn't it?
Exactly, yeah. I mean, I think that's the thing with Tom Murphy, like he's such a great writer that, you know, there's always certain amounts of relevance because he writes about characters that you'll recognise kind of local characters in the play. He kind of, they're very much real characters that he creates.
Real people.
Yeah, exactly.
Talking real stuff as well, you know. And
yeah.
He did.
Yeah,
the
everything's kind of...
It's a very famous play though, isn't it? It's not...
Yeah, it is. It's it's one of his earlier plays, but it is, like Druid have done it and went down very well in London and places like that. So it's one of the ones that a lot of his plays are just kind of put on in Ireland, but this is one of the ones that kind of went to London and other places with it.
Brilliant. And is this your first soiree into directing?
No, I've directed a few things before. I was a member of a drama group up in Dublin. So I directed with them, and I co-directed a few things with them as well. But this is my first directing with Belturbet Dramatic Society.
And with this one now, you're going to know these people. In Dublin, I'm sure you didn't know the people you were working with. But you know Sophie and you know Derek.
Yeah, yeah.
Does that make it harder?
Not really. Well, I actually, I kind of didn't really know Belturbet Dramatic Society when I started. So I kind of had to meet everybody then. But... I guess in terms of, it's going to be much more of a local audience now, so the pressure is on and a little bit more to kind of make sure that we put on something that people are going to enjoy.
And how's the directing, do you?
I do, I really like it.
Are you a hard taskmaster? No. Don't say it like that, don't say it like that. Or is she hands-on?
Well, I think, like, I really wanted this to be kind of a collaborative effort, and because the play, it's all about the characters, and the characters are so well written. And, you know, I like the actors to kind of bring something with them to the rehearsals, to work on their own characters themselves, and then I'll kind of maybe point them in a certain direction or something like that, and then hopefully we'll come up with something kind of better.
So what parts are Sophie and Derek playing? Before we get to them now, so keep counting them, because I'm on my way.
Derek plays Michael Ridge, the Irish immigrant that's returned home, and so... like he's come to terms with all of the changes that happened. And then Sophie plays, she works in the pub and she is the daughter of the man who owns the pub, J.J. Kilkelly. So she's J.J. Kilkelly's daughter, Anne. So she's essentially the barmaid in the pub. And, you know, Anne is kind of the symbol of hope in the play because she's young and she hasn't been affected by any of the depressions of the 60s and the 70s in Ireland, and she's kind of the future that they're kind of looking to. So every time she kind of comes in and out of the play, hopefully she's going to brighten it up.
and she does,
absolutely. Look. Absolutely. Yeah.
So did you have to audition, you two? Did you have to read for Fiona?
Yeah, we took part in a reading one night, and then Fiona took our details really, and if she thought we were suitable, she contacted us and let us know what part we
Brilliant. And it's hard, Fiona, but listen
to it. It is, yeah, it is. Because very, very talented.
Did you do it on your own? Had you an assistant director or anything like that?
I didn't have an assistant director. Obviously, the committee were there, and the committee have obviously helped me out massively, and they've helped produce this and direct it as well. But at that point, they kind of said, you know, there was so many talented people that did come to rehearsals, and I could have cast the play a couple of times. But with casting it, you kind of have to see how people are going to interact with each other, so, and different kind of ages, and try and get, there's seven people in it, so it was trying to get seven people that would work well together. That was kind of the difficulty, to try and get that. But I did, no problem, and
so worked it out well. We'll go to you first now, because we know Derek has a drug addict, Satan, from So what's your experience?
Well, I've been part of the Dramatic Society from a very young age. I used to take part in drama.
Just very young,
look
what you've got to say.
That's true. But yeah, I took part in a play actually last year, another Tom Murphy play. It was also presented by Belturbet Dramatic Society.
Is this something you hope to go for? Could you make a career out of this? Seriously, Derek, you're doing so good now.
Yeah.
It's building up for you all the time. You're working and working and working and working. But Sophie, what about you? Are you gonna, is this a career path, or is it a...
Well, I like it as a pastime at the moment.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, I love it, I have to say. Like, it's great social experience and that.
Do you find it hard?
No, not really. If you enjoy it, you wouldn't find it hard.
Yeah. Not in lines, though. How do you find that?
Not too bad, really.
Can you sing?
No.
No. I know Derek can sing because I've heard him, but anyway, that's a different story.
It's 4 a.m.
I see him singing at Louise Riley's party, wedding, but that was a different story.
It's a different ball game.
But Derek, but seriously, learning words is very, very hard, and it's hard enough to learn words.
Oh, yeah.
On a normal basis.
Yeah.
But then to have to perform in front of your peers and people you know and stuff like that. Again, I said, like I said to Fiona there, it's different when you're away and you don't know the audience.
Yeah.
But you're looking down and your mum, your brother, your sister, your cousins are there and you're going, and they're always in eye shot.
Yeah,
no matter where they sit, if they're at the back in the dark, you're going, oh, no, I can see them sitting there. I find that impossible, you know.
I know, you get used to it, like, you know, because in a way, you're not yourself on stage. Obviously, you're playing a character, and then the lines you're delivering is never, you're never going to talk like that anyway, normally.
And you have to get into that mindset, though.
You have to get into that mindset. You have to think of here's a guy that's from my character, Michael Ridge, if he's back from America and he's sort of failed over there, like, you know, and you have to bring that across that he's not, oh, I've come home, I've made it, like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And parts of it, he drops his guard and you can sort of see that, and wonder, maybe he's not, he hasn't made it, like, you know, so you have to sort of get into that mindset as well. And then as for learning lines, like, just have to keep going, keep repetition, you know, and then figure different ways. And Fiona helps you by, well, maybe try it this way. And then if you do it one way and she's not happy with it, she'd say, right, well, no, maybe we'll try it a different way, which is what a director is.
But she gives you a free hand. Do you give them a free hand? Do you say?
On some things, I mean, because obviously I want the whole play to work as an ensemble together. So if somebody's doing something one way and then someone's doing a completely different style of acting, you know, it's not going to link it
together. Do you act as well, Fiona?
I do a little bit sometimes,
You've been in here before.
But I mean, definitely what happens is they'll bring something to the rehearsals and then I'll think of something based on that. And, you know, that's kind of how we've been working. It's kind of been...
But you see, the test for you, Derek, is everyone's going to say, oh, that's your man at the Devil's Katie.
Mm. Yeah.
And they're going to watch you to see... Can you twist it round?
Yeah, yeah.
Because you were so believable in that. You were like an evil Shaggy Scooby-Doo.
Yeah. I know, you'd look for that all right now. But, like...
You're going to have to be an Irishman that's returning.
Oh, Irishman returning home. Like, a totally different character altogether, obviously. Like, you know, and then, you know, I suppose with people seeing you in the Devil's Kelly, they'll probably think, well, this bias to deliver a bit better again, like that, you know. So you're sort of... Even to yourself, you have to prove to yourself that you can do it. Like, you know, that, well, this is an Irish character now I'm playing. So you want to, I don't know, just bring it different. Like, it's a different character, you know what I mean? You can't really compare the two of them as such. Like,
the rehearsal's tough. Is it
the clock? I know, it isn't, like, you know, because there's times, like, you mightn't get your words out and it's frustrating for you personally, and then it's also frustrating for Fiona, like, that she's trying to, like, well, you need to, you know, she's on a trotter sometimes. Yeah. No, but she's right.
No, but she's right, but she's dead on the money.
You have to have that discipline. You have to be told what to do, like, because otherwise you could get lazy, you know, and then think, rely on other people to pull you out of it, like, you know.
You do continuity as well. Are you reading with them when you say, or have you a reader there going,
I try to keep it. Maybe they do kind of follow it. At this point, we're kind of at the start, yeah, there was a bit of that. But because it's very much everyone kind of, there's no big monologues in it. So everyone's in, six or seven people are interacting with each other all the time. So, I mean, you have to be on the ball with your cues for those kind of lines. There's no one person that stands up and says a speech that's two pages long that everyone can take a break. Everyone has to be on their game all the time.
And it has to look as normal as possible. Like we are chatting now.
Because that's what it is. It's a conversation on a homecoming. So that's kind of the feel that we want people to have, that they're just kind of eavesdropping on this conversation between these characters.
So how do you remember your lines? Have you any tips? Have you did your little... Everyone does the old back of the hand.
Well, once I get the line sorted, really what I do is I try to remember the person's line that's ahead of mine. So once they say that line, I know my cue. Or I try to learn their big chunk that's coming up, so at least I will remember.
It's mad because we've had loads and loads of people in here that are different. And nobody knows unless you do it.
Yeah.
Everybody sees the play and says, God, they're great crack doing that.
Yeah.
You know, for that, for the hour or whatever it is.
Yeah.
But nobody sees the commitment that goes into it.
That's huge.
The time that goes into it. Like, you've come from rehearsal today to be here to do this.
Yeah.
You rehearse in the morning.
Yeah.
Until Christmas Eve.
If Fiona had her own. They won't rehearse Christmas Day. No, they won't do it.
I'm going to give them a few hours off on Christmas Day and maybe St. Stephen's Day.
But when are you going on your 29th?
We're on the 29th, 30th of December, and then we're breaking for the New Year's, and then we're on the 2nd, 3rd, and 4th of January.
We're all in Belturbet?
All in Belturbet Civic Centre. In Belturbet, it used to be the town hall. It's a really great space, and hopefully now it'll be good.
And again, are you going to move it anywhere else, or is that it, or are you just?
Well, we're going to get those five nights over first out of the way, but we'll see after that.
I think you should move with it, because what people don't realise is you do these things and it's over.
Yeah.
You know, it's all of a sudden you say, God, I've done all that, and people say, God, I missed that.
Well, that's why I think it's good that we have it on the 29th and the 30th, and then we have a break, and then we have it on the next weekend. So hopefully, you know, people that are off over Christmas will get a chance to come down.
Is a big set?
There is a big set.
I understand. Now, you better give all these people, you better look into the green oracle there and just thank everybody, because
you bitch, you're running it in your head.
Brian McDermott is helping out with the set, and he's got Paddy Riley helping him and Justin MacDonald as well. So they're building the set, I think, as we speak. hopefully. So we're gonna start putting it into the Civic Centre then next week, and then working with it then from there.
Then dress rehearsal then.
Yeah, exactly. Technical rehearsal as well. Busy few days for the next.
Who's over costumes? If you say you're doing costumes as well, I'm gonna quit.
Well, again, the Belturbet Humanist Society, and I think Ellen was in today, and she was helping with costumes.
But it has to be 70s.
Exactly, yeah.
70s Ireland.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So we're pulling bits out of people's wardrobes that have things left over, put away from those days. And
I might have some.
Yeah.
I think I'm wearing one.
We don't have anyone that small.
So I can make Sophie my jacket.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah, I apologize.
You're not too cold, then.
Shut up,
Chris. Made in Belturbet. Why did you pick this play?
Well, I think it's a great play to do in Belturbet, because it's originally set in a small pub in Galway, so we've kind of changed it to Belturbet just to kind of make it
more homely.
Exactly, for people.
People can identify with it.
It's a really well written play, and kind of when I first read it, The way the characters kind of develop over the play, I mean, it's lovely to see, and I could see that working really well on stage. And you know, from a director's point of view, like that's kind of the part that I enjoy the most, is kind of getting the two characters having a conversation and getting them to react to what the other person is saying, getting them to listen to what they're saying, and seeing how that kind of develops over time, and kind of making more out of that, making more out of the words all the time. So because the language is so great, like that's kind of why I chose to do that one. So just hopefully now we do the play justice.
Now, and are you thinking ahead? Have you played in your head for the next one? You know, in music, you have to keep thinking. And actors too, they have to keep thinking, oh God, I've another one doing. Like actors, film actors make 4 films at a time.
Yeah.
What? Yeah. You know, where would you be going?
Yeah.
Jesus, I was in a play with Kevin O'Connor and them. I couldn't remember my name. Never mind.
Yeah.
It was mad.
Yeah.
You know, so do you think ahead, Fiona, do you say, right, after this I'm going to tackle a good comedy or a good horror?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you always have kind of plays in your head, and like I hadn't worked with Butterwood Drama Society before, so I guess now working with more people, you think of characters that maybe these characters would suit as well, and that kind of starts wandering around in your head. But definitely at the moment it's one step at a time, so I'll get this play first before I'll make any decisions about another play.
You better mention the rest of the cast.
Yeah.
You better. Talk to them there, talk to them.
Well, Well, obviously Sophie and Derek are in the play, and then Tony Henry and
Ian. Give them the characters' names as well.
Tony Henry is playing Tom. He is the writer, and he's also the local school teacher. And then Peter Donnelly is the auctioneer in the town, the local auctioneer. And then Julie McAvini is playing Tom's fiance, Peggy. And Emer Henry then plays Mr. Kilkelly's wife. Mrs. is what she's called throughout the play, and
Junior.
And most importantly,
don't forget anybody.
Most importantly, Junior is the local garage mechanic, and he kind of brings a lot of comic relief into the play, and he's played by Barry O'Reilly.
Barry, get on! No typecast there, then.
Definitely not.
Yeah, so that's, I think, all of the actors anyway. Yes. Yeah.
And you can just cast and crew. You can't do these things without a good crew either, can you really?
No, absolutely not.
And again, people give up their own time and go along and be at the rehearsal standing there doing nothing.
Yeah.
And again, people don't realise how much time there is sitting doing nothing.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
You know, you're going, and you're trying to learn your words, and you say, God, I'm going to do something now in a minute. And
yeah.
It's the same in any show business, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
90% of hanging around. Yeah. But the crack you have then at the rap party.
That's it.
That's what it is.
Well, look, Fiona, best of luck.
Thanks very much.
Fantastic. And we will be down to see you. Do you ever think about making a film?
No.
You should do it.
No, I'm strictly stage.
Is that a snobby thing? Is it an artist thing?
Not really, no. It's just a...
Because there is this thing about stage and movies and TV. There's three...
Yeah, I wouldn't have any idea what to do with a camera. I can see things kind of on stage, and that's kind of the way my mind works, so I'm going to stick with that for the moment.
And that's very hard, because again, a director is watching everything.
Yeah, and particularly when there is, a lot of the time, there's 7 people on stage all of the time, well, most of it. And there's generally 5 people on stage all of the time.
At any one time.
Yeah, exactly. So
tough stuff.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Right, tell the people again now where and when, and have your Facebook page and all that?
We do, yes. We do have a Facebook page of Conversations on a Homecoming.
So for you, admin on that, are you?
Myself and Fiona.
So the information is on there, but it's on the 29th, 30th of December, the 2nd, 3rd and 4th of January at 8 p.m. In the Civic Centre in Belturbet. And tickets are €10, which is very reasonable. So we really hope people will come along and, most importantly, enjoy the show. So,
well, you've got top class.
exactly.
Don't be attractive. But don't forget, don't miss that note from the 29th of December in Belturbet Civic Centre. That sounds so good, doesn't it? You know, where the normal hope without hearts.
hey ho.
This is a new going down, you know. Come down to Belturbet Civic Centre. Well, the very best luck, and as the saying goes, break a leg.
Thank you.
Very famous the phrase I have. My mother used to say to me, break a leg, son, but not really, because I love you. So the very, very best of luck. Well done to Fiona and Sophie and Derek, of course. And from the 29th, you can see that in Belturbet Civic Centre. I just need another excuse to say it.
Same old place, same old people, the same old church, the same old steeple. It's good to be home. Same old train on the same old track. It took me away, just bringing me back. It's good to be home. I'm the same old guy that I used to be, believe it or not. And I'm still the one who loved you so, and nothing in the world can make me stop. Same old rain on the same sweet hand. You're my baby, I'm your man. It's good to be home.